Tonight, I've actually got three kind of presentations for the rest of the while. I'm going to be talking about a mystery that I solved here 2 years ago that led to some really cool information about a family that has some members buried here. I'm going to give some information on the Knickerbocker Snowstorm and the Knickerbocker Theatre disaster. But I want to start with kind of the mystery, which kind of got this whole thing going. And some of you may have seen the articles I wrote in the Washington Post. This is kind of summing up that whole set of stories and mysteries. But I came here 2 years ago. It was July 29, 2012. And it's kind of funny. If someone would have come to me at the gate and said, "You're about to stumble upon a mystery that you're going to be working on for the next 3 months," I would have said, "No way. Way too busy. I'm not in the mood for a mystery. I want to come in, I want to get a photo, and I just want to get out as fast as possible." I was working on a book. The publisher had basically rejected photos from the book. It was the Knickerbocker Snowstorm book. Every week, they would reject a photo that would go into it. And I had submitted the book on July 4th. And here it was, July 29th, and they were still rejecting photos. I'm like, this is ridiculous. I've submitted my work. You could have rejected this a month ago. And one of the actual readers and comments on the Washington Post blog said, "You know, there are people, victims from the Knickerbocker Theater disaster in Congressional. You might want to get a photo of a Congressional gravestone." That's a great idea. I can get a super high-res photo. They can't reject it. It's too good quality with my DSLR. I'll come in, I'll get a shot of gravestone, and I'll submit it as my replacement photo. It's page 79, and I'll be set. I was going to be in and out. So the first thing I did was I called the director here and said, "I've heard there's some Knickerbocker Theater victims." And he's like, "Well, you can basically check our website. We've got a grant finder, you know, keeps on the website." So I'm like, "Okay, that's fine." I went to the list of victims that basically people who had died at Knickerbocker Theater. And one by one, I went down to the Congressional Cemetery website until I found a hit about halfway down, David Lyman. So I had David Lyman's grave coordinates, I wrote them down, I printed off the Congressional Cemetery map, and I came here that day, July 29th, basically to rush in, get my photo, that's all I needed. I was behind schedule with the book, 3 weeks, rush out, email it to the publisher. So I come on in, and I'm going to the grave coordinates, or I cannot find the grave. It just does not seem to be there. I'm scanning all the stones, I'm walking back and forth, I'm going from one coordinate to another. And it occurred to me, I didn't research a second name. I can't find this guy. I've come here for basically nothing. I need photos. So I'm just standing there, kind of perplexed, where it should be. And I look down, and there's these two stones matching with the name David Lyman on it. And they're not old stones, they're new stones. And it's like, this isn't going to work very well in my book, having a new person. But then I looked, and the date was right. It was January 28, 1922. So, as I compared, I saw the father and son, which was odd. You know, father and son buried together is usually, you know, husband and wife. And then I looked, and the father's date of death was 1 year within the son. And then I started doing the math in my head. The son was only 17 when he was killed. And that was the age of my oldest son at the time, 17, exactly the same age. Then I looked at the date that the father had passed away. It was about my age, like 1 year younger. And it just kind of struck me. It's like, here's this family, you know, kind of like mine, maybe. The son of 17 was caught in this horrible disaster. His father perished within a year, no sign of the mother around, and the stones were new. So somewhere, somehow, a family was watching over these two and basically giving them new stones. But then I started questioning myself. Well, I'm not a graveyard expert. Maybe I just don't know my stones well. So I found a caretaker, and I called him over. Said, "When do you think these stones were put in?" "Probably the 1980s. And again, the date of death was 1922 and 1923. So I actually hung around for a while and started thinking about it. And I think that's what kind of got me into the whole, you know, question, you know, really what happened to this family? Because before it was just a name, it was just a photo. And now it's a boy that's the same age as my son. And I came on the metro here. So on the way back, I was like, I'm going to search. I bet I can find the cause of death through ancestry.com. And I'm going to see if I can find what happened to David Lyman. So, since I got home, I got on my computer, on the internet, I did a Google on David Lyman. And the first hit was a lady named Debbie, who said, "I have photos of David Lyman and information from the Knickerbocker disaster if you're interested." Here, and that's bizarre. It's like, here's my work and home email. I was like, family history blogs, genealogy.com. So I emailed her work address, and it bounced back. She was no longer there. I emailed her at the home address. It didn't bounce back. A week went by, 2 weeks went by, no response. So then I started searching more. I got into ancestry.com and realized I'm really not good at researching, you know, family lineage. And I found lots of Lymans, and I saw them in the phone book. And I started thinking, I mean, imagine calling a family up. Did you have a family member 17 that you know of that perished in 1922? Do you have any information? I just did not feel optimistic at all that I could actually pursue doing that. So I almost gave up on solving the mystery. Ancestry.com at least let me know that the dad perished through tuberculosis. So that he died a year later from tuberculosis. And then all of a sudden, I get this email about 3.5 weeks later from Debbie. Said, got your email. It didn't have the photos and information. She left her phone number. So I called her up, and I met her out in Leesburg. And she had told me she had started to try to do the hook just like this. And, you know, things started going wrong, one thing after another. She ultimately ended up losing her job. She lost her husband. And she had just downsized into a townhouse in Leesburg, so she just abandoned the whole effort. But she had a single photo of David and a name that she had actually researched 10 years earlier, Frank Lyman, who was kind of like a family historian. He was in his late 60s. She said, he still might be in this phone number, give it a call. So I got home, called, there was just a voicemail, so I left the voicemail. And days went by, nothing. At least I had a photo, a little information from Debbie. Then one day at work, I left my cell number. I get this call. It has a real gruff voice on the other end. It's like, this is Frank Lyman. I got your voicemail. What do you need? And I'm like, it didn't sound too friendly. It's like, introduce myself, Kevin Ambrose. I work for the Capital Weather Gang, doing some research on David Lyman. Just wondered if you knew anything. His tone changed instantly. And he said, I have got photos, I've got information. Anything you want, I'll send you. So at that point, basically, went from like just waiting for these emails and phone calls to just this flood of information. I had probably more information on the Lyman family than I ever imagined. It's always nice when someone in a family is kind of like a family historian. So I've got that in this presentation. But what I want to do first is start with the context of what happened to David with the Knickerbocker Snowstorm and the Knickerbocker Theatre disaster. And once I kind of show you the whole disaster, I'll jump into the family story. And you can see basically what I learned from Frank Lyman and actually several of his family members that chimed in. So, the snowstorm itself, this is what caused the disaster. It was, and still is, Washington's biggest snowstorm on record, 28 inches. It was measured in Northwest DC, it's now measured in National Airport. It'll be hard to top 28 inches at National Airport. The snowstorm put a huge amount of weight on the roof of a brand new theater called the Knickerbocker Theatre. It was the top theater in the area. And ultimately, that's what led it to collapse. If you look, 3.02 inches of liquid content. It's like if it rained 3 inches, all snow. That was the weight that was on the roof of the Knickerbocker Theatre. Here's a kind of map. We were the bullseye, kind of like Snowmageddon back in 2010. The DC, Northern Virginia area took the brunt of the storm. There are some areas, even Rock Creek Park had 32 inches as measured. Just out of comparison, you want to see how our storm stacked up. It's quite hard to see on this. I'll read it off to you. Knickerbocker was 28 inches. In 1899, we had 20.5 inches. If anyone remembers the President's Day storm in 1979, 18.7 inches. And then we get to Snowmageddon, 17.8 inches, February 5th and 6th of 2010, and then it sort of trails on down from there. As with many snowstorms, there was a cold wave that preceded the snow. This is a shot of the Potomac River the day before the storm. That is actually a firefighter boat that was out patrolling. Now this is cool. There's a couple of things. You can kind of tell from this photo, but not so much. First of all, whenever there was a cold wave, the reflecting pool would be open to public ice skating, which happened quite often. The second thing, I wish you could see a little bit better, the little kind of fuzzy stuff on the side of the trees. They're all like 5 feet tall. If you go down to the Lincoln and they're The weather map here, that was hand-drawn, by the way. They didn't have computers, of course. Hand-drawn weather map shows the low-pressure system off the coast, off of Cape Hatteras, where all our big snowstorms usually blow up. And the detail is amazing. These guys, the weathermen, the meteorologists, they put their time in drawing weather maps. They didn't have much else. They didn't have computers. They didn't have satellites. They drew really fine weather maps. And what they also did was they posted their forecast for Washingtonians in kiosks. So think about it. We don't really have radio going in 1922. We don't have television. Of course, no internet. Even newspapers only come out once a day. So the forecast was issued twice a day. You would walk over there and put them behind glass. And if you wanted to check the latest forecast, this was on Pennsylvania Avenue. Walk down to Pennsylvania Avenue and read the forecast. I was put out there an hour earlier. They also had a barometer, a thermometer, a couple other weather instruments that they could check out. And the press loved to photograph these kiosks during heat waves and snowstorms. So there's lots of photos of these kiosks in the galleries and the archives, I should say. Here's the forecast. You probably can read it well, but the forecast for the day before the big snowstorm was fair tonight and probably Friday. Well, it ended up snowing, so it wasn't fair. And then the forecast for the day, when it was snowing, was snow today, tonight, probably Saturday, no change in temperature. They never issued amounts. They were vague, and they only issued about 24 hours in advance. So they really, besides drawing weather maps, the meteorologists of the 1922 era had it pretty easy. Now here's a street scene. Street cars ran throughout D.C., and they were keys. It's pretty clear. They had sweeper cars go up and down. And oftentimes the cars would then try to run the rails when the snow got deep. And occasionally they would run into a street car or at least come face to face, which you see here. And digging out this car in 1922 is just as tedious as digging out a car today. There's lots of snow to go through. I don't know if you remember from 2010, the scene is fairly comfortable, really. I find this funny. You're going to have a convertible. I don't want a 28-inch snowstorm to happen. The owner of this car probably had lots of fun. And before the disaster, everyone knew it was a historic snowstorm. Even in the 1920s, it didn't snow 2 feet often at all. It had all been back in 1899 since the other snowstorm of that size. So the press, photographers were out taking lots of photos. And here's a nice shot of a little girl about to go sledding, which of course runner sleds don't work in big, deep, fluffy snow. Here's a couple shots of young ladies lounging in a snowbank. Totally staged photo, it's pretty cool, but here's the cop pretending to direct traffic. He made a little snow mountain on the board. Of course, no cars are running, so he's just looking at the camera. The guy behind him is looking at a camera, so they're just doing it for a photo op. Well, so the snow fell all day. It accumulated probably at the time of the disaster, about 26 inches. It ended up snowing 28 total. And like I mentioned, the weight ultimately collapsed the roof. A lot of Washingtonians could walk to the theater, and so the theater was probably about half full at the time. Of the people in the theater, 98 were killed, 133 injured. Very few made it out unscathed. I mean, the roof literally came down as a flat surface, as a worst-case scenario. The U.S. military ultimately came in and led the rescue effort. Some of the victims were buried for over 20 hours. It was, when the balconies came down, a lot of concrete and steel to basically cut through and chisel out. And the fact that the military was there, all branches, helped speed up the effort. It was the news events really around the country. In D.C., thousands of spectators would literally walk and watch the rescue effort. And if you look at newspapers throughout the United States, they all ran front page stories about the disaster. And ultimately, the design, construction flaws, actually the code of design of 1922 was blamed on the disaster, and building codes were made much stricter after this disaster. I'll show you exactly what happened to the roof to come down. So here's the front of it, the face of the theater, the brick walls, 100% intact. It's just the roof itself just came down flat. And here are some nurses standing outside from Walter Reed. Okay, so here's looking down. You can see the entire roof is missing. And I don't even really see the arrows that I've drawn on the photo, but there's little notches in the brick wall about every 10 feet. And the code of 1922 for putting a roof on a big building was you basically laid the I-beams and trusses on the wall. That's all. You just laid them on it. And then you can build a mortar around it. So what you had was you had this monstrous theater. It was the biggest, newest theater in Washington, D.C., with a network of steel beams and trusses supporting a very heavy plaster and ceramic roof that were literally just laid on top of brick and block. And it had been built in 1917, so for about 5 years, the heating and thawing had been shifting the steel beams in and out of the mortar a little bit. In some places, they found the beams had kind of shifted to within 4 inches of the edge of the brick. And what happened was, when the weight of the snow started to bend the roof, the trusses and steel beams did not fail. They held. But steel does bend. And just the bending action raised the edges of the beams where it touched the brick and block, put more pressure on the corners of the brick, which then began to crumble. And then they were able to basically slide and break out of the brick. The entire roof came down flat at one time. Had it come down one side, the people on that side, of course, would have been impacted, but half the theater would have been fine. Literally slid out of the brick flat. What happened, let me ask this question to anyone. When you have a massive roof flying down inside of a building, do you know what would happen to the air inside?
Weak.
It literally got evacuated explosively. The windows and doors instantly blew out. People were lifted off their feet and blown through the windows and doors. And those people survived. There's lots of stories, maybe about half a dozen at least, of people who were lifted off their feet and blown through a window or a door that landed fine, shaken up. The people who didn't ultimately were, most of them were crushed in some form or fashion. The balconies were pulled down by the weight of the roof and the snow. So those came down on people, and that's what it took 20 hours to take the balconies out of the theater. There were stories of the rescue efforts where even though the roof came down flat, it buckled in certain ways in little pockets, and there were some, like two girls were found sleeping under, completely under in a little pocket. There were people who did survive and were not scratched. There was a story that the press ran with where they came and found actually a fairly large air pocket, and a man was sitting upright in his chair, found a single scratch. Debris had formed around him, but he had died probably of a heart attack.
No.
Just the fear, the fright. There were a number of survivors, but most of the victims were crushed, as you can imagine.
So let's do a comparison. This is the orchestra pit, before and after.
And that's not even when the balcony came down, that's just roof material. The orchestra had 18 men, of which 11 made it. The other could not make it through the snowstorm. They played with 11, 6 of the 11 were killed. The others that survived were up against the stage. The stage provided support. So there was a little bit of a pyramid or a triangle of sorts where they were able to dodge some of the material. Here's a scene of the balcony. I mean, that's 20 feet of concrete, steel beams, block.
How fast would this collapse have happened? Like, is there time to dive out of the way, or no?
So that's a good question. I should have mentioned that. There's a very interesting story from several of the survivors of seeing the roof slowly split. Mm-hmm. And then it started slowly spitting plaster dust. And there's a really cool story that was written up in the New York Times. A coal miner from West Virginia had come to D.C. and he had come for a show. He was all the way in the front, maybe three rows back. He notices the roof cracking. I mean, if you're a coal miner, you're looking and noticing that kind of stuff all the time. And then he sees it spitting dust. And he said to the reporter, he knew exactly, you know, what was happening. And he was 65 years old, but he still said as fast as he could run, he got out, ran up the aisle, and said everyone was sitting just watching the show as if nothing was happening, even though a cloud of dust was slowly settling, spreading out over the orchestra, he said. A couple other people that were standing near the doors saw that happening and saw something was wrong and stepped out in time. There was a reporter for the Washington Post, a drama critic, who always sat near the door because he liked to move in and out between the balcony and the lower level. And when he saw the plaster dust, he didn't feel right, so he took two steps out. Both the coal miner and the reporter were both blown off their feet and the roof came down, but they were unharmed as a result. So there was time. A few people did scamper out, but most people really just kind of watched the plaster dust wondering what was happening. And they had probably 30 seconds. Well, you could have gotten the whole audience out in 30 seconds, but there was 30 seconds of cracking and plaster. And it was bad timing because the show had just began. It was a comedy. Saturday night was when it happened. Saturday night was comedy night at Knickerbocker. And the movie had just started. The opening scene had just started creating some laughs. So people really focused on the action of the silent film. Orchestra was playing tempo for the scenes, which was the case in the 1920s. And the people just were so focused on the movie, they didn't really notice what was happening on the roof.
Where was the theater?
Yeah. I'll show you the location now. I've got photos of it. It's at 18th and Columbia's Adams Morgan.
Okay.
You'll never, I mean, when you see the present day photo of it, it's hard to imagine a theater of that size was on that location. There's a SunTrust Bank there now. So the military led the effort. Here are some soldiers carrying some of the wounded out of the theater. Walter Reed Hospital. Every hospital in the area handled the injured. There was a huge makeshift morgue that was basically put across the street. 98 people killed. They just basically sorted them. Let the family members come down to the morgue to try to find their loved ones. It seems like every cemetery in D.C. had someone buried. The list is really long. There could be a couple that are missing, but every hospital had the injured, and also every cemetery had the dead buried. One of the sad things that they don't really talk about that much is that family members had a very hard time identifying their loved ones. They often said, and even the case with the David Lyman we talk about, they identified them by their pants or shoes. And the press, when asked about it, said, well, there's so much plaster dust, you really couldn't recognize them. Which things were covered with plaster dust, but as you know, plaster dust is very easily wiped off. George Patton, you know, the George Patton of World War II, was a captain at the time. He was one of the military officers leading the rescue efforts. And he, in a letter to his father, explained exactly why they were unrecognizable. He said the weight of the roof and the balcony literally flattened the people to about 4 inches and made them completely unrecognizable and literally changed their color and appearance. And the press, no one else in all of the writings of the Knickerbocker described what happened. They just said they were hard to recognize, pants, clothes, skirts, that's what was used. George Patton went on, and it's probably in his fashion, to talk about it with his kids in great detail. And one of his daughters wrote memoirs and actually has a section about this snowstorm, this disaster, and the level of detail that her dad had told her about what happened, and how her mom started yelling at George Patton for being dangerous. And then Patton then barked back at her that they have to understand what happens in the real world. You can't shelter your kids forever, and these kids aren't this big. But it's very fascinating to see the very numerous letters and just the different writings that have gone on about this disaster. It's slowly being forgotten. I've come across many, many people in D.C. that have never heard of it or never really realized what it was, but it's still the biggest disaster in Washington, D.C. history. Ironically, the second biggest disaster was also a snowstorm. Anyone know what the second biggest disaster in Washington, D.C.?
Here, Florida,
yeah. 78. So this is another sad aspect about, it's probably more a sign of what the legal system was like back in 1922. All the families who lost loved ones filed lawsuits. There were obvious design flaws. The Knickerbocker jury basically said, you know what, we don't find anyone within the company, the architect, the builders, the owners, liable. You know what, it was a big snowstorm, you know, we're sorry. The Supreme Court immediately said, we're not handling any appeals, we're out of it. There were appeals, no one ever received a cent due to losing their loved ones. And the family who very hearing me describe the story. They were horribly impacted by the loss of both David and the husband, and the lawsuits that they and the peoples went unpaid. And that's part of one of the mysteries, and I'll explain it, the money situation with the family, why the family members got to do the great stones. So we'll get to that in a minute. Yes.
What was the breakdown of men, women, and children among the victims?
You know, I could sort it out, I didn't bother, but I'll tell you it was very, very sad, and that comedy night was a family night. So we had entire families that were wiped out. You had some families that were almost wiped out with one member. For example, there was one family that the mom hated sitting up front. So she insisted she was going to the back against the wall. She survived, her entire family up front was killed. There were situations where some of the kids survived and the parents, both parents were killed. There was a sad story about a newlywed couple who both were on their honeymoon and were killed. There was just lots of just stories that, just, like any comedy that is very family, lots of kids. Oh, we'll get back. So here's the site today. If you look behind the SunTrust, that row house was there. And the theater came all the way out past the great part of the frame across the plaza to the edge of the road. So it filled that entire space. The plaza right now is where the stage and the orchestra pit would have been. We're actually trying to do a little effort. We're going to get a plaque put out there and describe what happened, but we've not been able to do that yet. Here's a shot from where, say, the first row or two of seats would have been, looking out across 18th Street and Columbia Road at the end. So that leads me to the story about Congressional. I already described the mystery of what happened. And the opening, I kind of took you to the point where I finally found the family, found Frank Lyman, who was the historian of the family. And he provided the story, the photos, so I want to make sure I can try to get through this and give it justice. This is what I saw out there. This is what kind of perplexed me. I didn't see them initially walking back and forth because they're below the level of the grass, but they're new brand tombstones with 1922 and 1923 dates of death. And I got the story from Frank of David and Charles, they were cousins. So David, this is a photo of probably 14 or 15, he had been the usher right before the Knickerbocker disaster at Griffith Stadium. And he had this souvenir ball that was the prize of his family and of his friends. It was autographed by Babe Ruth, Ty Cobb, George Sisler, and basically a dozen baseball heroes of the early 20s. He worked at the stadium, so he was able to get in the field and get his autographs. Huge into baseball, big into sports. Here's a shot with his dad at the beach. It's interesting. I've done research on a number of victims from the Knickerbocker, and it's interesting. A few of them have beach photos. The beach, especially Atlantic City, was very popular in the early 20s, and a lot of them dressed up. They would go in suits and ties and lounge on the beach. It was a different time. So David is on the far left, and his cousin Charles is in the middle. Both boys about the same age, and there's a story about both of them, which I'll tell you in a second. So here's the athletic club, Riggs Athletic Club. Think of travel, baseball, travel, soccer. Back in Washington, D.C. in the early 20s, they had these athletic clubs, which basically kids from multiple high schools would conglomerate on these teams. They're usually the better players. They'll travel throughout Washington, D.C., maybe very northeastern Virginia, western Maryland area, or just east of D.C., and play other clubs. And they play year-round. This team, every Saturday night for comedy night, would meet at the Knickerbocker Theatre. They had their own little section in the balcony, left side up against the wall. And on that particular night of the snowstorm, most of the kids, being that it's a travel club, lived just a little bit too far to get to the theater. So only three of the entire team showed up. David also invited his cousin Charles to join him, so there'd be four. And phones, of course, were working back in those days, so they were able to get everyone together. David and Kirkland Duke, the tall boy. David is in a very white shirt in the middle. And Kirkland Duke went and got their tickets, 25 cents for a ticket to the Knickerbocker Theatre. One of the other boys went up with them, and they sat waiting on Charles. Charles, his parents wouldn't let him go until he finished his homework. His father was a military officer and basically used the theater as a way to get the boy to finish. So he rapidly finishes up his homework, and he had told Dave that he'd be just a little bit late. And he also lived in the walking distance. And the story goes, coming from the family, he was almost running through the knee-deep snow, got a block away, and heard the crash. So he just missed it. He was one of the first ones in, helped with the rescue, never found David, his cousin, and was basically distraught afterwards. David's mother, Josephine was her name, actually went to the morgue I told you about and recognized David by his Boy Scout boots and pants. And the official cause of death was his chest was crushed. You remember what I told you about recognizing people by their clothes, thus you can probably imagine why the boots and the pants were what was used to recognize them. As I mentioned, there was lawsuits. The Lyman family did a lawsuit. They had her brother, Josephine, was a lawyer in New York. And he was the one who led the effort. He then led the appeal, both lost. The father, who had tuberculosis, perished a year later and was buried next to him here at Congressional. They did have stones, but it was not the same stones you could see out there. Josephine was really traumatized by losing both her oldest son and her husband within a year. She never went to church again. Her excuse was that she didn't want to be caught crying in church. Not that she didn't believe in God. She just didn't want to have to go to church and be seen. She never remarried. She fell into financial difficulties with her family. She had another son and a daughter that were younger. Her brother, who was the lawyer, helped with the lawsuits, helped support the family. She did find a job in D.C. She worked in an antique shop until she passed away in 1957. By that time, the brother was already gone. There was not enough money for the stone, but there was still a little barrier in Congressional found the stone. They must have had some marker or some way to know where she was. In the meantime, Charles, his family, of course, was not impacted. He got an appointment to the United States Naval Academy a year later. He went to Annapolis. Did very well as an officer. In 1943, Charles was given command of the destroyer USS Hancock. Within 2 years, towards the end of World War II, he would command the entire destroyer division, Destroyer Division 10. At the end of the war, he became Assistant Chief of Staff of the Pacific Fleet. During this entire time, he remarked that a homework assignment could save his life, he would tell his friends. And his family would actually discuss it quite a bit, where Josephine's family never mentioned it. I'm getting all this from Frank, the historian of the family. In 1945, Frank, who's the one who gave me all this information, was kind of, oh yes.
This is really interesting, but can I actually just speak a little louder?
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. In 1945, Frank, who's the nephew, was going through his grandmother's, Josephine's belongings, found a baseball that was autographed. And he went ahead and he and his buddies, who didn't have a lot of money for baseballs, played with it for an entire year. He said he has a vivid memory of the day the skin came off and he left it under a bush in the front yard. And only later, when the grandmother found it missing, did he realize what had happened and significance. Of course, he wishes he would have even just kept the cover. But he told me that story when he gave me all this information. As I mentioned, when Josephine was buried in 1957, they didn't have the money for a stone. Finally, in 1978, Ada Sr., one for David Jr., one for Josephine. So actually, I'm going to try to run my track. I've not seen Josephine's stone, but it should match. And somewhere in the same sector. But since they died within decades, they could not bury them side by side. So I put a lot of this together for a Washington Post article. I loved the reaction of the family because they all saw the links in the way the article was written. And they were very appreciative of it. I've got a few more slides to show you of the family. This is the Washington Post article that mentions David and Kirkland and how they had been killed in the theater and school, Western High School, which when they went to school, stopped playing sports for a week. This is hard to see, but this is a high school, this was a yearbook page. It's just a big white page with just small letters that said, Memoria, may this page forever keep fresh the memory of our dearly beloved friend and classmate, David Lyman. To live in hearts to leave behind is not to die. This is Charles. He came back very successful in World War II and wrote a book, Exit with a Full Heart. And the book, of course, was way out of print, but the family was nice enough to mail a copy to me so I could photograph it and get quotes from it. And I mailed it back to him. And I'll just end with saying this was just one of like eight stories like it that I've been able to piece together after I got going on this first story. And like I said when I began, I had no time, I was not in the mood for mysteries, but once I got going, I've got this whole slew of stories that ultimately someday I'm going to put together in a book. But you've heard the story of David Lyman and his family, and at least the Knickerbocker Snowstorm. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, you can ask me now or just catch me afterwards. I'll be able to answer.
Are others other victims buried here?
There are a couple others. There's a guy by the name of Tracy who has a very large monument. There's two or three others here. They're spread out throughout many of the cemeteries in Washington. Yes?
Did the snowstorm ultimately get its name from this disaster?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Wait, what was that question?
What was the question?
Did the snowstorm get its name from the disaster?
Almost immediately, the snowstorm was associated with the Knickerbocker disaster and was called the Knickerbocker Snowstorm. Yes?
What was the movie they were watching?
it was a brand new comedy. I've got it in the book. I can look it up for you in a second. I can't remember off the top of my head. There's actually two movies that day, and that was the second. One other note, I brought Washington weather books. They're a nice copy table book for $10 if you're interested. I'd be happy to show you the books.
What did they do after the... they cleared the debris and the roof and all that. Did it just stand as a shell for a while?
Yeah,
did they
rebuild it?
Yeah, so the question is, was it rebuilt? Yes, it was built into another theater, as a matter of fact. And one of the families told me that when they went back years later, they were watching the movie Cyclops, I think it was in the 50s. And one of the older members who had lived through the Knickerbocker was terrified, not of the movie, but of the roof. The family found that very fascinating. Yes?
Did you ever get a photograph and went there to the cemetery in the first place? Did you ever get the photograph of the tombstone you went to the grave or the dead originally for your phone?
Oh, that was what I showed you, yes.
Did you need a certain time?
I cropped it. And I sent it, it's on page 79, I can show it to you. But it said it's one of the two, if that was the question.
And they accepted it.
And they accepted it, yes. But you know what, they rejected one more after that, too. And I found out, the publisher is Arcadia, and they did a book for the cemetery, actually.
Yeah.
That is their style. They will push the authors to continually look for better photos. And it works, because I will tell you, it frustrated the heck out of me, but after 2 months of constantly getting photos rejected and going looking for others, I definitely improved at least three dozen of the photos in the book.
Frank's dad? Or?
Yeah, Frank's dad and aunt. So David's brother and sister. And they did that in 1978. They may have since passed away. Frank is about 78 now. He was the nephew. Yes?
So what was the reason for rejecting the photos? Was it the content, composition, or just...
Well, there's two things. They have a piece of software that will literally run the images and detect poor resolution. It's an algorithm they use. So some of them, they didn't even look at. I mean, there are awesome photos, and a couple I protested. I'm like, look, it's 1922. This is an awesome photo of a policeman. And they accept it once they look at it. Then others, they're just like, you know, it's not that relevant, it's redundant, we just don't like it. It's not a good photo. So it's a combination of both.
Yes. Can you identify some of the photos that you didn't talk about that are on the screen right now?
Yeah, so these are some of the different stories, and they're just very fascinating. So upper left, the conductor, he was killed. He had his wife at the theater, and the wife brought the best friend's son, who had never seen a movie, he was 9 years old. She was buried to her neck in debris. Her 9-year-old friend's daughter, her son, was killed. Just terribly sad. The very interesting thing about the conductor, you see the man, the close-up to on the right, that was his brother. They were playing together. The brother survived, had lost an arm. The newspaper articles of the day had her name swapped. So in the article, the conductor survived, the French horn player died. So even though the conductor's wife was horribly injured, she was traumatized by losing her best friend's son, she made it almost a mile and a half through the snow to go see her husband that was supposedly injured in the hospital. And the newspaper articles, a lot of this in the newspaper articles, basically she goes in, she sees his brother, hears the news, and passes out. So that was very traumatic. The lady with the hat, Agnes Mellon, another one of the stories that I stumbled across when I was researching the Lyman story, she was engaged to be married. She was going to the theater with her fiance. They had gone to her sister's house and tried to talk the entire sister's family into going to see the movie. Sister didn't want to go see it. Then she said her sister's son, who was 5 at the time, he's never seen a movie. Can we take him to the movie? And she said no. And Agnes persisted, kept saying, can we take him to the movie? And finally the sister said, no, he's going to catch a cold. I'm not letting him go. And the boy would always remember that because, of course, he didn't go and he survived. He would always remember that discussion and ultimately the conversation was written down. So it happened. She rushes off. Her last words were going to be late. She rushes off to the theater with her fiance. They go rushing through the door. He gets blown off his feet, back out, lands unscathed. She was just far enough in, she was crushed by the balcony and killed. He was ridiculously traumatized and would literally hang out at the sister's house. The sister then, this all family stories going to be, became very bitter because he was a constant reminder that he survived and her sister did not. And the family story goes, he finally realized that he was really not that welcome and he never married. But I found him on ancestry.com. He moved to Chicago and he didn't marry. This is a really interesting story. The far right corner, she is one of the founders of the Girl Scouts. And she had just been on this huge Girl Scout campout. And it was a story that she actually wrote down. The interview was well documented. She had a lover spat, a quote lover spat, with her longtime boyfriend. And she was going to show him, and she went out on a date that night to the Knickerbocker Theatre with someone else. First date, another man. And she goes there, the roof collapsed, he gets killed. She's injured fairly badly, but she makes a full recovery. They instantly get married. 3 months long, 3 months later, the two get married. Boyfriend who was left out. And then she gets an award by, I can't remember the name of the president, Harding. Harding's wife gave her an award, heroism, because she apparently, first of all, was a Girl Scout leader. And she had led the rescuers to her little pocket of people by calling out. And it took almost 18 hours to get her out of there. So she was decorated, and they're actually doing another Arcadia book of Girl Scouts, and they're including her in the book. Bob Wright, John Daly, he was a reporter at the Washington Post, who I said stepped out just in time. He was a drama critic. He was really low in the chain of the Washington Post. Because he was there, he had the story. His story made front page news, the Washington Post the next day. It was then recreated by the New York Times and multiple papers across the U.S. He got an offer from Newsweek out of New York City and basically jumped from being drama critic of the Washington Post to the mainstream reporter for Newsweek within a year, based on the disaster. And then, just one last, you can see George Patton really looked like in 1922, lower right. So those are some of the stories, and you know, like I said, at some point, I'm always so busy, at some point I want to put together the story of each one of these families into a little book of short stories. Any other questions?